Some of the success stories of Mrs. Thatcher's Britain can now be examined from the air. Last week, we flew by helicopter over the so-called M4 corridor between Heathrow and Swindon, which is one of the fastest growing areas in Europe. With us was industrial property agent Peter Mantle.
Now, there have been tremendous changes in the industrial property market in the UK, which really reflected changes in the economy. There's been a reduction in manufacturing industry, the old metal batting industries, and a rise in the knowledge-based, computer-based industries.
The corridor is an economic powerhouse of modern high-tech industry. Foreign companies like Digital and Panasonic have flocked to invest. Commercial property values in the best areas have soared to £2 million an acre. As prosperity has grown in many parts of Britain, the result has been a surge of imports. Last year, Britain bought almost £20 billion worth of consumer goods abroad and another £14 billion worth of capital goods for industry. With exports unable to keep up, the result was a massive balance of payments deficit of more than £14.5 billion, with the same or worse predicted for this year. One key area is cars. 10 years ago, Britain earned more selling cars abroad than she spent buying foreign ones. Now the situation is reversed. Last year, with exports flat and imports rising, cars left us in the red to the tune of £4.5 billion. One of Britain's most successful industrialists, Sir John Harvey-Jones, the former chairman of ICI, believes the trade gap is a problem that cannot be dodged.
Well, I think this is a national problem of such a force and gravity that it needs understanding and clarity on everybody's part. Ultimately, the chickens come home to roost, and they come home to roost in the form of a reduction in the relative standard of living that you have against other people. And that'll bring us back, instead of being rich men who can afford to buy a cup of coffee in Switzerland, to being, as I remember as being many years ago, feeling really poor when you went to Europe and seeing the other Europeans moving ahead much faster than we were.
With gloomy predictions for the current year, this now looks like the worst trade problem since the war. In recent times, Britain went into the red during the oil crisis of 1974 and again briefly in 1979, the year Mrs. Thatcher came to power. In cash terms, the latest plunge into the red is among the most serious in our history, comparable, allowing for inflation, with the 74 crisis. What the figures for Britain's oil show is that the surge of earnings in the early 80s helped to hide the basic trade problems which are now being revealed as oil earnings decline. A key part of the deficit is in manufactured goods. Exports have generally risen, but imports have normally risen much faster. In 1983, Britain went into the red in manufactures for the first time in our peacetime history. The Treasury told us that they do not see the trade gap as a major problem. They believe it is exaggerated by poor statistics and will resolve itself as consumer demand drops. But the Treasury was unwilling to take part in the cut and thrust of this programme. Last week, we approached the Treasury and asked to interview a minister on the same terms as everyone else contributing to this programme, namely that the interview would be recorded and then edited in order to form part of a debate on the central issues concerning the trade deficit. The Treasury said that the subject matter was controversial and that a minister would only appear if his interview went out uncut and at the end of the programme. We therefore approached a well-known economist who broadly supports government policies to put their point of view in the normal way. Professor Minford is one of the charmed circle of economists who enjoys Mrs. Thatcher's respect.
We have a very global marketplace, and we shouldn't get frightfully excited if in one year the accounts don't exactly balance. Sometimes we're in surplus, sometimes we're in deficit. And whether this is a good thing or a bad thing depends on whether the policies being pursued are good for the health of the nation long term. And at the moment, the policies being pursued are extremely good for the health of the nation.
Past chancellors faced with such bad trade performance have sometimes devalued the pound. But Nigel Lawson sees the main enemy as inflation. But just across the way from the Chancellor's rectory in Leicestershire, on the other side of the village graveyard, is one British manufacturer who simply doesn't believe that that will happen. Less than 100 yards from Mr. Lawson's constituency home is one of the most modern and productive hosiery factories in Britain. It's a company where people work hard on up-to-date machinery, supplying tights and stockings for well-known brands like Christian Dior. The company chairman is John Brindley, who says the Chancellor's high pound has stopped his company's exports dead in their tracks.
Well, this is a very modern company, possibly the most modern fashion hosiery mill in Europe and maybe the world. We have ploughed all our profits through the years into the latest machinery, latest technology, marketing, and we're brand leaders in our field. But in today's marketplace, we're no longer competitive. The high pound is affecting our export drive. It's making it almost impossible. We're faced with severe competition from other areas of the market, and I seriously have to look at our moves for the future.
The factory also illustrates what some believe is a deeper problem than the rate of sterling. At the heart of the operation are rows of advanced knitting machines. They were made in Italy, and the only British supplier is now out of business. Building the machines that make goods is another sector that used to earn a large surplus for Britain and no longer does. The government believes that these kinds of imports are a sign of health in the economy because goods will be produced more efficiently. But Sir John Harvey-Jones says that after 10 years of Thatcherism, Britain is still lagging behind its main competitors.
If you do in any study, for example, of the age of the machine tool stock in Britain, it is something like 3 times as old as the Japanese and twice as old as the Germans. Now, there have been enormous advances in machine tools. And you look at almost any of these things. I mean, if you go to any factory in Britain, a totally new, totally re-equipped, automated factory, hardly any people, all computer controlled. How many of them do you know? Very few.
In the shadow of high-tech Britain are many old industries for whom the trade figures simply mean yet another period of struggle to survive. Cazonia Knitwear is in a sector that has always been vulnerable to cheap imports and is once again finding it harder to compete in Britain, let alone abroad. Some similar companies are now faced with closure. Cazonia got through the last slump in the early 80s by sharp cutbacks and improvements in productivity. The result was better profits, but optimism is once again starting to fade as foreign penetration of the British market goes on. The firm's owner, Roger Godby, has sunk both money and effort in his attempt to turn the company around.
I can't say that I would necessarily do the same or recommend the same again today, because the level of imports, encouraged by the strength of sterling today, is making it very, very difficult to compete both on a UK base and also making it almost impossible on an export base.
There are new manufacturing companies making healthy profits. AWD in Dunstable is a brand new track maker already seen as a success story of entrepreneurial Britain. Last year, AWD exported some 2,500 trucks and is vigorously seeking foreign orders. But its efforts are still just a shadow of the past. AWD occupies a part of what was once the giant Bedford truck plant, which finally died a lingering death in 1987. In this sprawling complex in the late 70s, Bedford used to make some 30,000 trucks a year. AWD is currently making 6,000.
Thank you, sir. £20. I bid £30 against you. 30 at the back, 30 at the very back, 40.
Some critics argue that Britain is now paying a price for the wholesale factory closures, which took place shortly after Mrs. Thatcher came to power in 1979. Large sections of British manufacturing were lost. Machinery was auctioned off. Investment fell dramatically. Today, the amount we manufacture is rising quickly again, but has only just passed the level of 1979.
From 1979, a great restructuring took place in the British economy. Many manufacturing industries that were fairly old and were really being heavily subsidized by the taxpayer were rationalized. This was necessary for the long-term health of the economy, because it's no good having money ploughed in to industries that can't pay their way long term. Now, of course, that shows up in the fact that those industries no longer export.
So, in effect, you don't believe it was a blunder to allow that capacity to export to die?
No, because it wasn't profitable. It's better to use your resources where you can make a profit. If you redeploy your resources where you can make a profit, the nation is wealthier. It grows more, you get higher productivity, and we are all wealthier.
There's no doubt that since the slump of the early 80s, the performance of many of the companies that came through the crisis has improved. Management is better, and productivity has been improving sharply. But at the same time, the number of big companies that are world leaders has declined.
There is no doubt that the survivors are better managed and are more effective, but it's a pitifully small number. And you see, it is on those flag holders, if you like, that everything depends. I mean, when Mercedes-Benz sell cars all over the world, they aren't just selling Mercedes-Benz cars, they're selling the products of hundreds, in fact, thousands of small German component suppliers who supply them. And that's going in the markets of the world. That's an export from Germany. Where's our car industry? What chance is there for the small, maybe very efficient, component producer who was in the Midlands if we've lost our preeminence in the car industry? How does he, what are his chances of selling to Mercedes-Benz in Germany? Not very high. What are his chances of selling to Mercedes-Benz in Germany if the exchange rate is against him? Zilch.
In 1984, the House of Lords appointed a committee on trade to consider what some believed was a looming crisis. Britain had just slipped into the red in manufactured goods. The Lords heard from Chancellor Lawson and the Treasury that as oil revenue declined, the problem would correct itself automatically. But the Lords' findings were gloomy.
These prospects constitute a grave threat to the standard of living of the British people. The situation in which we find ourselves is not self-correcting. Things will not come right of their own accord.
The chairman of the House of Lords Select Committee was Lord Aldington.
My real difference with the Treasury is that they don't understand what's basically wrong behind this. And the basic thing that's wrong is that the level of manufacturing output in Britain is not big enough. Not big enough in terms not of my or their estimation, but of what the British people want to buy. If the British people want to buy 25% more goods than are produced here, we are in for trouble. And that's, if they lecture to me on market forces, I lecture back. What better market forces than what British people want to buy?
I put to Professor Patrick Minford the fact that Britain is now in the red in manufactured goods for the first time under any government, Labour or Conservative, since the war. Did he regard it as significant?
I think this is of no significance whatsoever. It's an interesting fact which reflects the changing structure of this economy. In that sense, it's significant. The economy structure has changed substantially. We have lost our comparative advantage in many of the older style manufacturing operations that we had going in the 70s. And we are now developing a comparative advantage in services, things like the city and so forth. We are also developing a comparative advantage in certain parts of the newer manufacturing industries, such as electronics and some parts of engineering. This is a success story. I don't feel guilty in any way. I think that the House of Lords committee is really unable to grasp the nature of a modern capitalist economy.
One part of the modern economy of Britain is a holiday village under a glass dome near Robin Hood's Sherwood Forest. This holiday centre attracts some 300,000 guests a year. 10% of them come from abroad. It was as manufacturing declined in the early 80s that service industry became a buzzword. Some experts spoke of a leisure society. And in its evidence to the House of Lords, the Treasury said that foreign earnings on services might make a growing contribution. But the balance sheet of the last few years shows that the picture is not so rosy. One recent disappointment has been in the City of London, where Britain's earnings from the sale of financial services to foreigners have recently failed to take off as hoped. Big Bang was supposed to make the city more competitive, but it happened at a time when other world financial centres were expanding and taking business that had traditionally been done through London. Foreign earnings from the insurance business have seen a decline. Across the range of service industries, the figures are currently depressing compared with past results. The figures, roughly adjusted for inflation, show that throughout the 1970s, there was a rapid improvement in the contribution of Britain's service industries to the balance of trade. Since then, the figures have generally disappointed early hopes. After foreign spending is deducted from foreign earnings, Britain is still in the black in services. But last year's figure is sharply down. It was affected, among other things, by large numbers of Britons going abroad on holiday.
Now, there aren't an infinite range of goods and services which can be sold overseas. I mean, a lot of play was made at one time about tourism, but, you know, we also send people overseas in tourism who wish to pursue tourism ourselves. They have to be paid for as well. And you don't need to do many sums that you'd end up with wall-to-wall tourists in our country. There simply wouldn't be any room. And the thing is self-defeating. So tourism, while everybody who can contribute to the balance of payments is welcome and should do their best, I don't see any solution there. I never have seen any solution from selling financial services, for which we're allegedly so famed and meant to be so world competitive, and that looks a bit sick now if you look at the City of London. Ultimately, we have no recourse but to make our manufacturing more efficient in world competitive terms.
In Cambridge is one of many new companies that have sprung up to turn British brain power into high technology goods that can be sold abroad. Synoptics started in a Cambridge scientist's living room in 1985 and now has a turnover of more than £1 million a year. It makes advanced computer software, which it sells to manufacturing companies abroad. The aim is to carve out a specialist corner in a tough world market. Managing Director John Shave believes that Thatcherism has provided the right environment, but he has no illusions about the problem of expanding exports.
I think it's going to be very difficult. We do run a big deficit at the moment on trade and on information processing. And I think we're going to find it quite hard to get the mass market for that. But I think we have to try, and I think our business is to provide a lot of what I've called intellectual added value, where you have to put in a lot of extra brain power into the products that you produce. And I think that's going to be our raw material. It's not going to be metal or steel in the future. It's going to be brains. And I think that's where we have to add value in the future.
But as really a corner of the world market, no more.
That's right, exactly.
The dream of a Britain supported by high technology is still a long way off. In many areas of high-tech trade, Britain still imports a lot more than we sell abroad. Firmly in the present is the Ideal Home exhibition and what remains of the consumer boom. A boom that was fueled by credit and by the widespread belief that greater prosperity was here to stay. It is now overshadowed in the view of the government's critics by the simple reality that Britain is not producing enough of what Britons or foreigners want to buy. Another reality is that foreign manufacturers are determined to go on increasing their share of our markets. AEG is one West German company that has invested heavily in the future. In their plant in Nuremberg, robots bring half-finished products to the workers. The assembly line is gone. At present, AEG has a small quality market in the UK, but the company believes it will expand.
It is our intention to expand our business by about 15 to 20% per year, which means by 1992, we hope to have doubled our present business volume.
In spite of trade figures that reveal increased penetration by imports in key areas of our home market, Professor Patrick Minford believes that the trade gap will sort itself out under existing government policies.
I expect this to run for 3 years or so at levels somewhat lower than now and gradually diminish. And I would have thought within 5 years we would be back in balance.
The story is a success story. You have no doubt about that whatsoever. There's not the slightest inkling of doubt about the path that's been followed and the consequences of it.
The story of the British economy since 1979 is of a remarkable success story, yes. I am confident that over the next 5 years we'll see continued success. And obviously mistakes can be made, but I think that they can be avoided.
There's no question that the mass of our people have had, the majority of our people, I'm sorry, I should have said, have certainly lived under better economic conditions in the last five years or even 10 years. But so they should, because we've spent all the damn money that we got from the North Sea oil supporting their standard of living. So they should, because again, we've sold off all the things that we already own in privatization. I mean, and if that money goes into actually, and it hasn't gone into, according to the government, into the infrastructure, and certainly by observation, it hasn't gone into building marvelous new roads and all the things that people complain about. So where's it gone? It's gone into our pockets. So of course we've lived better, but it's, I believe, a fool's paradise.
Actually make markets in the dollar one, so, but I can actually get you a level...
Whether the truth is miracle or mirage, it's a fact that Britain's trade deficit is being paid for by an inflow of foreign money. The government says it's a sign of foreign confidence in Britain. The critics say that most of it is hot money drawn in by high interest rates. In their view, the situation is now unstable. If the foreigners catch fright and sell, a sterling crisis could damage the British economy. In Frankfurt, West Germany, last week, a top city analyst arrived to speak to investors about the British economy and prospects for the future. He's Tony Barron of the Chase Investment Bank, and the message he brought his clients would not have pleased the Chancellor.
Decidedly optimistic against the background.
In the audience, representatives of German financial institutions holding sterling investments worth billions. They heard Tony Barron express deep concern about the trade deficit and predict trouble ahead for the British economy.
Looking at the British economy, we see the beginnings of a return to the bad old days of the 60s and 70s, when the balance of payments were a major constraint on growth in the United Kingdom. The policy...
Barron advised his clients to prepare to sell sterling later in the year, one reason being a future worsening of the balance of payments, or as economists call it, the current account deficit.
I am warning them that in the near future, their holdings of sterling could be at risk from a devaluation of the currency because of the continuing problems with the current account deficit in the United Kingdom.
Why are those problems so pressing, in your opinion?
Well, they are quite pressing because the current account problem is continuing to develop. The Chancellor is actually talking about the current account deficit falling over the coming 18 months. But realistically, we think it's going to continue to rise.
In the global marketplace, it is the money men, many of them foreigners, who may well deliver an important verdict on the performance of Thatcherism in the 10th year of the Prime Minister's period in power.